somehow maintain the partnership with the self, and without doing any deconstructive takedowns, okay, if that's possible, that's almost, it seemed to me almost like an ethical assignment to keep alive that partnership and that coupling with the self, so that there can be and must be interlocution. It's as if not only was Eichmann dumbed down, but became deaf and dumb to the self as a partner.
Yes.
That he had no splitting where he couldn't, her question, one of her questions, and I'm wondering, is it a possible ethics anymore? Because does that resonate for our nearly schizoid ears mm-hmm. anymore?
Mm-hmm.
Can I live with myself?
Mm-hmm.
What does it mean to live with oneself? And here again, I might point to Larry's immense corpus of considerations of, let's say, relics that are incorporated, dead bodies that are carried with. All of that has been remastered and cleaned up in a sense. Mm-hmm. Arendt's not going to go there.
Mm.
And so we can perhaps leave that to a sidebar in our encounter and rendezvous with this crucial. Because I was asking, what is her assignment for us? I was asking, as was Larry all night, what is Judith's assignment? But then I also said, okay, let's calm down and ask also what's Arendt's assignment.
Mm-hmm.
And it's almost, and this may be my own issues and projections, the exhaustion that must be involved in and the high maintenance of this partnership with the self, because you have to keep that part of the self talking to you and saying, are you crazy? She even has different utterances, like it shouldn't be said, ooh, I shouldn't have done that, or that shouldn't have been done. There should be the utterance, I can't do that. I can't mess with someone else's peace and all
yes.
that.
And I think we might actually consider what it is to be open to an appeal mm-hmm. from oneself, and to be open to an appeal from another, and how those actually are in some sense connected in thinking and in what we might understand as a kind of ethical demand that thinking makes, no?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm reminded of Nietzsche's opening of On the Genealogy of Morals, where the bells strike, but you know, the philosopher hears nothing or hears too late or misses the, because responsiveness has been in some sense decimated, right?
Mm-hmm.
The grounds of responsiveness have been decimated, which might be one reason why we need to leave the philosopher aside in order to ask what is called thinking.
So this would be a departure from conscience and Gewissensruf and other type figures of ethicity, but there's some partnership that has to be somehow pumped up all the time, it seems to me.
Mm.
And maybe we can all reflect as we go into the splendor of the day for 2 seconds and return.
Okay, thanks for your patience.
Yeah.
You have to pay, you had 2 questions, no. It seems like on the one hand you're asking whether the world is ever achieved, and the other question you're asking is whether solipsism is ever achieved. At least that I heard both of those.
That's the dichotomy.
Yes. Okay, so let me address this for a moment, and I think this is an important moment. Let's turn to 99 if we can. And let's note that in this paragraph she makes a distinction between isolation and solitude. Okay, and I think that might actually also be interesting from a Kleinian perspective. She talks about isolation in terms of being alone in a crowd. It occurs when I am neither together with myself nor in the company of others, but concerned with the things of the world. Isolation can be the natural condition for all kinds of work where I am so concentrated on what I am doing that the presence of others, including myself, can only disturb me. Okay, so that's interesting. So it's a kind of absorption or concentration in which I'm neither dialoguing with myself, nor am I open to whatever anyone else is saying to me, nor am I speaking to anyone else. There's just a kind of persistent I. So isolation. Such work may be productive, the actual fabrication of some new object, but need not be so. Learning, even the mere reading of a book, requires some degree of isolation, of being protected against the presence of others. Okay, so I'm not sure that's solipsistic exactly, but let's just say it's a withdrawal or a concentrated withdrawal from alterity. It doesn't break those relations or rupture those relations. It simply backgrounds them in such a way that they're not active. There's not an active dialogue going on. Okay. Isolation can also occur as a negative phenomenon. Others with whom I share a certain concern for the world may desert me. This happens frequently in political life. It is the enforced leisure of the politician, or rather the man who is himself a citizen but has lost contact with his fellow citizens. Isolation in this second negative sense can be born only if it is transformed into solitude. Okay, so I've been deserted. I'm a man, apparently. I'm political. I've been deserted. And this can be born only if it becomes solitude. So what is solitude as opposed to isolation? Everyone acquainted with Latin literature will know how the Romans, in contrast to the Greeks, and this is her Republican streak, discovered solitude, and with it philosophy, as a way of life. Okay, so solitude is going to be the situation in which I keep company with myself, right? It's not isolation in which I'm not talking to myself. It's I'm keeping company with myself. I'm becoming philosophical as a way of life in the enforced leisure which accompanies removal from public affairs. So it's after being deposed from politics that philosophy becomes possible. It might even be in the aftermath of political defeat or political desertion that philosophy and a certain kind of company with oneself emerges. Now what I find most interesting is this final bit. When you discover solitude from the standpoint of an active life spent in the company of your peers, you will come to the point at which Cato said, and this strikes me as really very important, never am I more active than when I do nothing. Never am I less alone than when I am by myself. You can still hear in these words, I think, the surprise of an active man, originally not alone and far from doing nothing, in the delights of solitude and the two-in-one activity of thought. So actually, what is she? She's actually giving a sort of quasi-narrative structure to this rhythm of becoming concentrated in doing something, which is a kind of isolation, working with others or a multitude as part of politics, and that isolated action can be, in fact, part of politics. And then achieving solitude only after having been in politics or with others, establishing the two-in-one. Never am I more active than when I do nothing. There is a certain kind of, what is she saying? She is saying there is a certain kind of activity in having this dialogue with myself. So there's an activity in thinking, which we thought was maybe not active. And never am I less alone than when I am by myself. Being by myself in solitude involves a certain kind of internal population. So what appeared to be outside, multiplicity and action in the public sphere, become in fact